Next up is Mark Zuckerberg. We're so psyched to have him back here for, I think it's the third year in a row. Thank you for coming. We're going to do some Q&A.
I'm just glad I didn't have to participate in the last session.
You know, Paul.
You guys are brutal.
Paul would have said, "You know what you can do, Mark." He would have probably done that to you.
I think one of the coolest things about Silicon Valley and all the technology that's been built up is that you can just try all this stuff, right? So Paul's up here giving you guys awesome feedback, but I think one of the awesome things is that, you know, you can take it or you don't have to take it, and you can try it. And I don't know. It strikes me as one of the awesome things that's happening in the world right now is that just because of all this technology that's been built up, everyone can just go try out their ideas, and you don't have to go through any intermediary.
I'm so psyched you brought this up, because one of the questions I was going to ask you, I'm going to skip all over the place, but Facebook has, for where you are now, you have this sort of unique philosophy of, like, you have this willingness to kind of break things and try things out, and sometimes it works, sometimes it breaks. So was this a conscious effort, or where did you get that idea to have this willingness to break things?
Well, we made this observation early on that most companies mess up by moving too slowly and trying to be too precise, right? And when you're making mistakes or moving quickly or doing anything like this, you want to make mistakes evenly on both sides, right? So we wanted to set up the culture so that we were equally messing up by moving too quickly and by moving too slowly some of the time, right? So that way we know that we were in the middle, right? I mean, another example of where we have this is in hiring, right? I mean, if you have too high of a accept rate on people who you're making offers to, then that probably means that you're paying people too much, right? I mean, you should get, in order to find the market equilibrium, you should be messing up equally on both sides. So, I don't know, I just think that that's a mistake that that most companies make too much, is they move too slowly, they're too afraid of making mistakes. We have this saying that I try to put into almost every all hands at Facebook, that the biggest risk is not taking any risk, right? Because the world is changing so quickly, right? And sure, any given risk that you might take, you might mess up, and it might end up being really bad. But in a world that's changing really quickly, the only strategy where you're guaranteed to fail is not taking any risk and not changing anything. Right, so you have to take risk. So the biggest risk is not to take any risk. I think that you just want to manage things so that you basically, you're not making the mistakes that everyone else is making. Of course, we're going to make different mistakes, but I think that's cool.
Okay. All right, so we've been talking today. A lot of people during their talks have talked about early days, and you know that's my favorite part. I always ask you about that. So early on, tell me about one of your biggest technical problems or bottlenecks that you had.
Well, the biggest issue, I think, that we had early on, I mean, if you look at the problems of social networks as opposed to some of the systems that came before, you know, whether it's search or Yahoo-style content where they're showing the same kind of content at massive scale to a lot of people, the first generation web problems were all about scale, right? How do you index this massive amount of information? How do you take a piece of content and serve it to a huge number of people and build up the infrastructure to do that? And one of the solutions to that that everyone adopted and built up was good ways of caching, good ways of building these scale systems. With social networks and these new types of social software, it's a little harder to do that because everyone has a fundamentally different experience. If I go to a search and type in Jessica, I'm going to get a different set of results based on who my friends and friends of friends and people or pages that the people who I care about have liked than anyone else here is going to get. So that makes the technical problems of caching just a lot more tricky. And I think that one of the defining things about Facebook is we are an extremely technical company. I mean, the people who started the company were all really technical. I mean, the caching stuff that I just mentioned, I mean, I basically implemented the first version myself. The first version was really rough. I mean, now we've scaled it into, I mean, Memcache. It's this big open source project now, and it's, I mean, I don't even recognize the code anymore. It's so different. I mean, now it's like it handles multiple data centers and like 100,000 times more throughput. But I think that having a company where, especially when you have these kind of technical issues, where you have the same people thinking through the product challenges and the experience that you're trying to create, all the way down the stack to actually implementing it is a really critical thing. And I don't know. I'm not sure if I have quite as much empathy for the current set of technical issues that a new startup would have today, because I'm sure they're different than the ones that we had when we were getting started. But I think that same principle of having the people who are making the product decisions also understand all the technical trade-offs is actually, it's like fundamentally valuable in building a product.
Okay. So way back then, how fast did you grow in terms of employees in like the first year? Do you remember? Leading up to another question.
Oh, we didn't. I mean, I was in denial that we were going to make a company. The way we evolved, I think, is probably pretty weird. So, I mean, when I was in college, I had a lot of conversations with my friends, usually over pizza, about the direction that we thought the world was going to go in. And to us, it was just like, okay, clearly, eventually, there's going to be this API and this platform that every application that you use is going to be social, right? Because everything is better when you have your friends there, both on an emotional level and a kind of information efficiency level. You can find stuff more easily. You get matched up with better stuff. So it's kind of we kind of assumed that would happen, but we just figured, you know, it's like, why would we do it? We're college students. I was a sophomore at the time. I was like, surely there are companies that are more competent than us at doing this. And I think what it turned out is, you know, we didn't want to start a company, but we started building it. I mean, I started building the first version, and then my roommate Dustin joined, and then Andrew joined us, and he was with you guys for a while at YC, I just think we cared more. I mean, so we cared more about seeing this happen than anyone else. So we just kind of at each step along the way, even though we weren't the most qualified, we built it and we worked hard. But we didn't expect it to be a company initially. I mean, we were just building this thing because we thought it was awesome, right? And we wanted it to exist, and we thought it was going to exist. And originally we built it for just our school because we wanted it there, but then all these other people started writing to us and asking for it. So we said, okay, well, we can start expanding it, and then more of my friends joined. You know, so it was sophomore year, and my freshman summer, I had stayed in Cambridge working at some programming jobs around Harvard. So I went to Dustin and I said, you know, I don't want to be around Boston for this summer. Let's go out to Silicon Valley, where it's like seems like this magical place where all these startups come from. Surely we'll learn something. Maybe one day we'll make a startup. clearly, this isn't a startup. I mean, it's Facebook, whatever. So we moved out, and and just as an added touch on top of that, we got a couple of interns. We had this programming competition. It was not like in the movie. There was no drinking or hacking, but there was a programming competition. And we took the two best kids, and we all just lived in a house. And it was a lot of fun. And then, you know, I mean, we'd gone through iterations. I mean, we tried setting the company up the first time. It was like a disaster, and we didn't actually set it up correctly. We set it up as an LLC based out of Florida, because that's where Eduardo happened to live at the time. We knew nothing about anything, like, in setting this stuff up. And we just kind of iterated and kept going and made, like, a ton of mistakes. But and then finally, I guess we got hooked up with a good lawyer out here, and we incorporated and decided, okay, we're going to turn this into a company. It probably wasn't until a year or so after that we stopped working out of our house and finally got our first office in downtown Palo Alto, I think right above the Haagen-Dazs. And I don't know. I actually think we still have a lot of that spirit today. Like fundamentally, we never went into this to build a company. I think it turns out one of the things that I believe this now after kind of living with it for 6 years is that I think a company is actually the best vehicle in the world to align a lot of really talented people to make some change that you want to make. Because you can, if you succeed, then you can reward people both on a mission level for what the organization is doing and financially. And so you can pull in people with all these disparate talents who are awesome at these different things. And you know, so part of building a company is, you know, making sure that you're rewarding people, making sure that you're building a strong revenue stream and profits, that you're sustainable. But I mean, fundamentally, I mean, I think we still actually have the same outlook. I mean, we're doing this because we think that what we're doing is awesome and it should exist, and no one else is doing it yet.
I wanted to ask you about that. You're up to like 3,000 employees now.
A little less, yeah, but a little less. Right around there.
So what's the difference between running a company that was only 50 people versus where you are now? Because you guys have a great culture, I know that.
I mean, one of my friends, I think, put this pretty well. When you're engineering, one of the kind of fundamental things about engineering is that you never do the same thing twice, because if you're going to do the same thing twice, you just abstract it, right? And so when we're building a company, you know, first you start off and you're writing code yourself, and then you kind of write abstractions for the codes, that way more people can handle it, and then you're engineering with other people and setting up systems that you can engineer together, then maybe you're managing a small team, and then maybe you're managing people who are managing teams and all that. And like building a company is no different than the normal process of engineering, I think. You know, what is management and what is engineering? It's taking a problem and decomposing it down into smaller problems, right? And when you do that, what you end up with by the time that you have a company of whatever it is, 2,500 or 3,000 people, is you basically just have a lot of different 50-person teams. And the 50, I mean, 50 people is even too big to think of as a unit of a team. I mean, think of 3, 4, 5 people, I think, as a unit of a team. And when you do this well, you've decomposed the problem well, and you're thinking really clearly about what the problems are. You have clear definitions and clear distinctions that you've empowered everyone to go do their thing well. And when you're not doing it well, then your company is basically a mess, and you set up all these dynamics where there's a huge amount of politics because the lines aren't clear between things. And but I don't know. I just think it's engineering all the way up and down.
So tell me a little bit about your growth group, speaking about how you're organized. Like, that's very unique to Facebook. And tell
not
me...
Not anymore.
You started it, though. Tell me about it, and tell me when what they discovered that you're like, oh, my God, glad we have a growth group and not, like, making it an implicit goal for everyone to be focused
well,
on.
Well, one of the fundamental kind of the first insights that we had was that one of the main features of Facebook or one of these networks is that your friends are there, right? So while with any one of your companies, of course you want it to grow, right? You want more customers and you want to increase the impact that your company is having. But for a company like Facebook, it's actually deeper than that, because in a way, one of the biggest features that we can provide for people is that when they come to the service, their friends are there and that we can help them find them easily. So on two levels, both strategically in terms of wanting to grow and scale the company, and in terms of trying to give people a better experience, which these things were aligned, we decided we weren't just going to leave this to chance and try to build features and hope that things grew over time. We wanted to build a core competence at the company of growing and scaling and helping people find their friends more easily and helping them map out their connections. So I think in companies, one of the decisions that you make as you're managing a company is you have to choose all these things, whether you're going to centralize or decentralize them, right? And, you know, I mean, a big example normally is, I don't know, what's a good example? I mean, marketing, right? It's like, do you have a separate marketing group, or like, do you have each team do their own marketing, right? And it's like, usually it's a little bit of both. But when you want something to really work, normally you centralize it, right? And you say, okay, I want someone whose only responsibility it is to make this thing work. And you give them that focus and you kind of decompose that problem. And we decided that we were going to do that with growth. Growth is kind of the slang. I mean, the team is called spreading Facebook, right? And getting people on Facebook. So we set up that team. And I actually think it's one of the best operational things that we did. We learned a huge amount about our users and their patterns on the site and what helps them stay connected and stay engaged, and basically what are the key things to help them use the service. And it's actually one of the things operation that we've exported to a bunch of other companies. I know Dropbox, for example, recently started a growth team and a bunch of other companies too. And I would really advise you guys when you're at the right phase of your growth, once you have a product that you're happy with, you want to centralize things like that are competences that you want to build up in your company.
Can you think of something that they happened upon that, like, surprised you? Like, wow, that's so cool.
Yeah, I mean, so one thing was we didn't really have great analytics before about what would make it so that people who used Facebook would stay engaged or what wouldn't. And we came upon this magic number that you needed to find 10 friends, right? And once you had 10 friends, you had enough content in your newsfeed that there would just be stuff on a good enough interval where it would be worth coming back to the site. Because if you think about it, the point of using Facebook isn't to use the features of Facebook, it's to use it to share and connect with all these people. So 10 is basically the minimum. So we re-engineered the whole flow of having someone sign up to get all this extraneous shit out of the way and just make it so that the only focus at the beginning is helping people find people to connect with. And we honed what the tools were to get them to do that. But it's going to be different things for different companies. But I think for each of your companies, once you get a core product that you're happy with, I think it's worth going through and having the discipline to basically do this exercise.
That's cool. So to get to where Facebook is now, you had to turn down a lot of acquisitions along the way. If you had to give advice, like a little how-to guide on how to handle acquisition offers along the way of growing your business, what would you say?
Well, so we really had one phase of this. And I think, you know, the only reason why it's this big story that everyone knows that we turned down a lot of money is frankly because I messed up the process, right? I mean, if you don't want to sell your company, don't get into a process where you're talking to people about selling your company. Honestly, I think that was one of the biggest management mistakes that I made through Facebook's whole history. It was interesting because I learned a lot about the team, and I ended up turning over a lot of the team after that because I kind of discovered that a lot of people, being able to sell a company for some number of hundreds of millions of dollars or $1 billion, it's huge. I mean, that's an awesome outcome, but that's not what I was in it for, and I wanted people around me for whom that's what they were in it for, was to build a company for the long term. So it ended up being a really interesting event just to kind of see the psychology of a number of people around me as we were going through that process. But I mean, the biggest thing is you should know what you want to do, right? I mean, you asked the question of how do you turn down offers. It's not clear to me that the answer is that you should turn down offers, right? In our case, it was because, I mean, not because the company went on to become more valuable, because it was what we wanted to do, right? And if you start a company and you own and control the company, I mean, you should take the company in the direction that you think it should go in. But that said, there are a lot of really good reasons why people do sell their companies, and often I'm on the other end of that now because Facebook is now an acquirer of a lot of companies. And you know, I really respect it when I talk to people. I talk to a lot of entrepreneurs, and when people are, you know, I really want to build this, I respect that. But one of the big reasons why people want to sell their company, to us at least, is because they feel like there's a problem that they can solve that's different from what their startup is doing, right? And I mean, take for example, I mean, one of those companies that we bought was a New York-based company called Dropio, right? And we bought that company, and a bunch of the folks joined, and the CEO of that company led the Timeline project at Facebook, which is going to be rolling out pretty soon. And the reason why that person joined is because, you know, we had a long time, we spent a long time together, and he decided that he was going to have a bigger impact working on that at Facebook than he was with his company, and that he thought that it was going to be a lot of fun working together, which it has been. So I think he really likes that decision. But I think that the core thing that you need to keep in mind is that if you go through some big corporate change, whether it's selling the company or some huge investment and you change control of the company or something, it's just not going to be the same, right? If we'd sold to Yahoo, they wanted to do something different than we wanted to do with it. If what that company wants to do is aligned with what you want to do, then selling isn't that bad. But if what you want to do is build it out with the original vision, then I can almost guarantee you that selling your company to someone else is not going to be the best way to do that. So just don't do it.
Did you even meet with people really early on who might have wanted to buy you for much smaller amounts of money? Curious.
Yeah, but I mean, we really had no idea what we were doing. So,
Okay.
Yeah.
So I want to ask you early on about raising funding.
Yeah,
just a little bit. It's out there. The story's out there that when you were in Boston, you met with Battery Ventures, and I want you to go back to that meeting and tell me sort of how you pitched Facebook, and how they responded to it. I mean, clearly they passed, and perhaps that was a mistake. They said, but take me back. What was it like? How did they respond?
I don't know. I barely remember that. I agree that it happened. I don't think I said anything. I think Eduardo said some things, and then they did not want to do it. But it's fine because I wasn't going to do it anyway. We were at this phase where, a lot of the way that I've run Facebook is, Facebook, I think, at its essence, is the products that we build, right? So as a CEO, I want to make sure that I'm spending the vast majority of the time that I have on building those products and recruiting people who are going to build those products for the long term, and that's kind of how I spend my time. So in order to do that, you need to have a really strong team around you. And at each step along the way, that's one of the things that I focused on. So early on, Eduardo thought, you know, okay, we need to, one of the things that we need to do is raise some money. And I was just really skeptical of VCs, still am, but there's some good ones. And you know, that's one of the reasons why eventually we ended up taking money from Peter Thiel, is because I felt like he could relate to us on a founder level, and he really has lived up to that through the whole time that he's coached Facebook and been on our board. He has given us advice from the perspective of a founder and not a money manager, which I really respect and can relate to. And even, you know, I mean, there's the story that has been told a lot about how we ended up taking money from Excel, which was, I wasn't going to take money from a VC then either. We were going to take money from Don Graham, who runs the Washington Post, because I felt like this is a guy who's had this company in his family for generations. He knows something about running a company for the long term, right? And I felt like that was really lacking in all the interactions that I had when I was talking to people around Silicon Valley, because everyone was talking about flipping companies and all that, and it just felt, it was really unattractive to me. So so I was thinking, okay, well, we were very far down the path of taking money from Don, and then at the end, he was like, you know, you have this other offer from Jim at Excel, and I've worked with Jim on some things, and he's actually gonna be a lot more helpful to you guys than I am, so you should take that. And I was like, really, really? So at the end of the day, I got the best of both worlds. We got the investment from Jim, and Don is now on our board. So, but that was a pretty good experience. But I don't know. I don't actually think VCs are bad. I just think you want to make sure that you find people who are aligned with you. That's really important.
So, back, you know, early on, tell me about something that surprised you. I'm sure you ran into some surprises early on. And do you still get surprised by things?
Yeah. I don't know. I feel like the way that I talk about the past, I think it's pretty clear that most things were surprises. I don't really pretend that I had any idea what I was doing. I don't know. I think, like, so there's all these weird surprises. I mean, like, one of the philosophies that we have is, like, there's, like, 1,000 things going on at any given point in time, and there's, like, 1 or 2 that actually matter. And you need to focus on those. So you can be surprised. There's probably like 1,000 things that surprised us, but of smaller magnitudes. I mean, probably the most inspiring, surprising thing is that you can be so bad at so many things and like learn along the way. And as long as you stay focused on how you're providing value to your users and customers, and you have something that is unique and valuable that you understand and that you're providing, then you get through all that stuff. I mean, there's this tendency. I remember when I was, I'm a really impatient person, and you can just ask anyone who works with me. And you know, in our first years, I just always felt like we were like so close to dying, right? Or like it was like right around, you know, it was gonna, you know, Google or some other company was like right about to build our product, and we were gonna be screwed, right? And I mean, look at how long it took them to build our product. but. You end up having a lot of time, and you have time to learn. You're not going to know everything going into it up front, and I don't know. That's okay. Just, I mean, stay focused on the stuff that you're providing to your users. You're going to make a ton of mistakes. It doesn't matter. You don't get judged by the mistakes. People don't remember those years from now. They remember the things that you did that were good. So
why did you get it right? I mean, half this room probably doesn't know what we're all doing. But why, like, are you Mark Zuckerberg? You know, like, why, what did you do right to win?
I spent a lot of time thinking about that. I mean, there's probably something about how my mom raised me. You know, good Jewish mother, you know. Go home, get 99 on a test. Why didn't you get 100? Come on. I don't know. One of the things that worries me when, I mean, so I think stuff like this is awesome, right? It's like you guys are all out here, you're thinking about the companies that you want to build. I mean, this is actually potentially one of the only parts of the American economy that's going really well right now, right? Is that stuff in technology is growing really quickly. And I mean, you guys, you have the power to just, I mean, you can sit down, you can code something, you can try it. It doesn't matter to you whether someone thinks it's a good idea or not, because you have the power to go put that online and, you know, and see whether it resonates and connects with people. Totally lost my train of thought.
Why you're so great.
Maybe I tried to change the topic.
I asked the question because a lot of these people want to be as successful.
Oh man, I totally forgot where I was going with that. I don't know. Let's go on to the next question.
Okay. All right. So you did a lot of other projects.
If I remember where I was going, I'll come back.
Yeah. If you remember, then interrupt me.
I will.
Because I think it's really important. I want to know the answer to it. That's why I keep asking.
I remember. Okay. So. I do that all the time. I was just like really spacey. Okay. So. I think that this is actually one of the awesome things about the American economy now. And one of the things that worries me is that there's this culture out here in the Valley of people going to start companies before they know what they want to do. Where it's like, you've decided that you want to start a company, but you don't know what you're passionate about yet. I actually think there's this huge self-selection bias where, like, because I didn't go into this trying to start a company, the only way that I was going to end up starting a company or running a company was if that thing had so much momentum that it was going to go carry itself despite the fact that I didn't want to start a company and make me go start a company to do it. I don't know. I'm not saying that that's the only way to do it. Clearly, people have all these stories. I mean, Jeff Bezos, clearly, I mean, one of the, I think, great entrepreneurs of our time, who I really respect. I mean, he very clearly knew that he wanted to start a company and then wrote a business plan on a napkin while, I think the myth is, while driving across the country to Seattle. So there's all these different ways to do it, and I think you shouldn't just try to emulate one model, but I do think you need to do stuff that you're passionate about. I mean, I think I'm sure there's this huge bias towards the companies that work are companies that the people really cared about and had some vision for what they wanted to see exist in the world, not just because they wanted to start a company. So I do think, I mean, if you want to be on a path where you're going to be psyched about what you're doing, and I mean, I listened to what Paul was saying earlier, and I really agree. You know, if you are doing a company and it goes even moderately well, you're doing it for 5 years, right? And so do something that you like.
That's good advice. Back when you've done a lot of projects before Facebook, was there a moment when you were working on Facebook that you were like, "Oh wow, this is going to be big"?
No, I mean it just kind of kept going. The big thing that I really wanted to do was build out this development platform. I was talking to my friends about building out a platform before I even started working on Facebook. And Facebook, I think, it's this great app, and it's this great thing where you can, you know, you can stay connected and see what's going on with your friends' lives. But I think that the story, when we look back on this in 5 or 10 years, is going to be disproportionately that the apps and things that were built on top of Facebook are what people remember about this time in the industry. I mean, I often talk to our company and outside the company about this narrative where the last 5 years of social networking have been about getting people connected, right? The next 5 years, or whatever it's going to be, 5, 10 years, are now going to be about what are all the things that you can build now that you have all these connections in place. And I mean, just like anything, I mean, it took a while for the internet to get wired up and for it to get enough adoption that that people primarily started building internet software instead of shipping CD-ROMs. Right? I mean, there was a time in the 90s when, like, and there were companies like AOL that they just, like, sent out a ton of CD-ROMs. And then there was, like, this tipping point where there were still a bunch of companies doing CD-ROMs and a bunch of companies doing internet stuff. And, like, if you just picked the wrong one, then you died. And like, I think that we're probably at, like, either at or very close to that inflection point with social software, too, where it's like you can not build stuff on top of a social graph, or you can build it on top of a social graph. And I think pretty soon it's just going to be this point where like all of the stuff that you guys are going to build are going to be on top of something like this in some capacity, and it will be a losing strategy to not do that. And I think that the real story that people are going to look back on is going to be that, not any time that people spend on Facebook.com or anything like that. So, what was the original question? I think
forget.
I got there.
No, I forget. I'm going to ask the last question, which is, can you think of a story besides the LLC, Florida LLC, from when you were really small, like two or three people, that you would do differently? Like a story that you really screwed it up and you'd do differently if you could go back in time.
Well, if I were starting now, I would do it very differently. But I knew nothing back then. So, I mean, one interesting thing is, I mean, so how many of you guys are actually from Silicon Valley versus are traveling out here for some period of time? Well, maybe let's do the inverse. How many people are traveling? All right, so it's like a meaningful amount. You get this feeling when you're out here that you kind of have to be in Silicon Valley, right? You have, and there's all these great engineers out here, there's great universities, there's a lot of great VCs, and you can get people to help you set up a company well, so that way you're not structured as an LLC in Florida. You can rent data center space, like all this stuff. It's not the only place to be, I think. I think it's actually, if you're a beginner, and you don't know anything about this stuff, it's actually an excellent place to be, because a lot of the stuff that you wouldn't understand how to do on your own, like I didn't, I could just get help from a lot of other people. But honestly, if I were starting now, I just would have stayed in Boston, I think.
Really?
Yeah.
Why?
I don't know. I think like there's a difference in there are aspects of the culture out here where I think like it still is a little bit short-term focused, right? In a way that bothers me. You know, whether it's like people who wanna start companies to start a company, not knowing what they like, I don't know, to flip it, or like people, I don't know. It's I think, you know, I had a conversation with Bezos about this one time. The average amount of time that someone stays in a job in Seattle is almost twice as long as it is out here. And I mean, that's not necessarily good for itself, but if you believe that like the first year of doing anything, you're just kind of like learning what the hell you're doing, and then like to do anything really good, it takes like at least a few years after that. I think there's this culture out here where like people just kind of like they don't commit to doing things, right? And they don't feel like they're, I don't know, and there's nothing wrong with experimentation too. I mean, you need to do that before you kind of dive in and decide that you're gonna do something, but I don't know, I feel like a lot of the companies that have been built outside of Silicon Valley, I just think, seem to be on a longer term cadence than the ones in Silicon Valley for whatever reason.
So you would have stayed in Boston.
I don't know, maybe.
The reporters
I like New York too.
The reporters in Boston will love that.
I'm not sure. I haven't run that experiment. But I think it's definitely an option, is I guess what I would say. Right? You don't have to move out here to do this.
But what about all the sort of serendipitous things that happened to you out here?
Oh, no, I knew nothing, so I had to be out here. Facebook would not have worked if I'd stayed in Boston, but like I think that now, knowing more of what I know, I think I might have been able to pull it off. And I think that there's enough, I mean, one thing, it kind of goes back to your first question about, like, why do we try to move quickly when the mistake that everyone else makes is moving too slowly? And my whole analysis of kind of you want to make mistakes on both sides, I just think that there's such an advantage to doing things differently than other people are doing in ways that, like, I don't know if you can even express it mathematically. It just, like, I don't know. Just if you, doing something that's different from what everyone else is, you could fail miserably, right? Because often there's a reason why no one else is doing it. But that's how you really win, right? I mean, if you're doing something that everyone else is doing a little bit better, then, like, how much can you win or change the world doing that? So, I don't know. I think like there are great people all over the world. There are great engineers who are probably not going to move out here from all these different places. And I don't know. I think like the more, I would just like, as advice, I mean, I give this to all of our teams at Facebook. I mean, just like, it's like, what are you doing that's different from like what everyone else would do if they were solving this problem? And there's probably ways to gain different advantages and do things that feel different and are better in different ways just by doing things differently.
That's a good place to end.
So.
That's a great place. So thank you for coming.